So welcome to the first lecture in our ambassador series for this year. We are very happy to have Ambassador Sabine Nölke, who is here, the Canadian ambassador to the Netherlands, as well as the permanent representative of Canada to the Organization for the Prohibition of Chemical Weapons. She holds a BA, an MA, and an LLB in English Literature from the University of Western Ontario, and an LLM in Public International Law from the London School of Economics and Political Science, as well as an honorary LLD from the University of Western Ontario. Her diplomatic career started in 1992, and since 1993, she has specialized in international law and is increasingly responsible for different areas with a focus on international peace and security, human rights, terrorism, humanitarian law, and international criminal law. She has served abroad at the High Commissioner of Canada in London and with the Canadian delegation to the Organization for Security and Cooperation in Europe. And prior to her appointment to the Netherlands, she was Director General for the Non-Proliferation and Security Threat Recognition Bureau.
Reduction Bureau.
And we're very excited to have her with us today talking about migration issues and immigration issues in Canada. And so I know all of you have regularly discussed how Canada is kind of leading the way in many migration issues, and she's here to talk to us about the Canadian experience. So I'll turn the floor over to you. Thank you for being with us.
Thank you. Thanks very much, Melissa. Given that you're all, I think, studying these matters, I hope that I'm not telling you things that you already know. If I get too simplistic, please raise your hand, or you can always ask me more specific questions at the end. But first of all, I'm very happy to be here, again, thanks for the invitation. I decided to put the presentation today into four parts, and I'll put them up. The four parts aren't here. The first one, just generally the Canadian context. What are the basic elements of Canadian society and our geography? And that'll be very quick. And then the second part, our origins as really a conglomerate of indigenous nations, French and English, and how that has marked our society. Then the third one, how do we deal with questions of multiculturalism and integration that successive waves of immigration have brought? And then finally, the question of our commitment to resettling Syrian refugees more specifically. And then just a couple of very general conclusions. The Canadian context, and I'll go here. I mean, most of you will have seen a map of Canada. Although if you're European, you will think Canada is quite small because it usually occupies one page in an atlas. But I'll show you the next slide. I guess this isn't working all so well. So we forget about the slides because they seem to be skipping. We can fit Europe, including the European parts of Russia, into Canada twice. Mm-hmm. So it's if you take out the Russian bits, it's more like four times. The Netherlands you can put into Lake Ontario. So it's quite a large place and very sparse population density. For example, Nunavut, our Aboriginal governed territory, has 20,000 people in it, and it's roughly the size of, I think, non-Russia Europe. So it gives you an idea. It's a very, very large country. We are wealthy. We are a wealthy nation, excellent natural resource base, as well as a modern, innovative manufacturing and services economy, and a very highly educated population. I saw statistics just last week. We have the second highest percentage of college-educated people on the planet, so very highly educated populace. Then, of course, there are evident challenges to nation building that come that arise out of the scale. If you live up north, the challenges of living there when in communities that can really only be reached by plane, because there are no roads up there, then it's quite a different environment. I know that a lot of my German aunt used to tell me, said, how come Canada doesn't take more people? It's such a big country. Said, well, you can really only live in bits of it. and about 90% of the Canadian population lives within 200 kilometers of the U.S. border. So that gives you an idea how sparsely populated the North is. Then, of course, social cohesion becomes a problem out of that. Our basis in diversity really started in our founding days. Of course, Canada was originally settled by our Aboriginal and Indigenous population, and then the so-called founding nations of Britain and France came in about starting around the 15th, 16th century. Aboriginal peoples were in Canada for thousands of years. We recognize three groups of Aboriginals. What you in Europe here would mostly call Indians, we call them the First Nations, the Métis and the Inuit. Inuit are, again, what Europeans would call Eskimos, but that's actually quite a derogative term, so don't please use that one. Mm-hmm. And the Métis are a population that is mixed race, essentially Aboriginal and settler. They're distinct peoples for us with unique histories, languages, cultural practices, and spiritual beliefs. More than 1.4 million people in Canada identify themselves as Aboriginal, and that's about 4% of our population. There are 617 First Nations communities representing more than 50 cultural groups and over 50 Aboriginal languages as well. About half of Canada's original population are First Nations, 30% Métis. 15 are what we call non-status Indians, and there we use the term Indians. It's actually, it's a legal term based on the recognition of what makes you a status Indian in Canadian law, entitles you to certain legal entitlements. In terms of residency, in terms of taxation and other issues, and then 4% Inuit. And about half of our Aboriginals live in cities, live in urban centers. Now, as a country, we're a construction based on the two founding nations, namely British and French. I'm gonna see if I can call up a, They're not all of the slides are in the presentation.
There's some
that are missing, but that's okay.
No?
I can make it up as I go along. the first European contact with Canada was in about the 10th or 11th century. The Vikings did make it all the way to L'Anse-aux-Meadows in Newfoundland, and John Cabot landed in probably Cape Breton or Newfoundland in 1497, so only 5 years after Columbus. Jacques Cartier in 1534 claimed lands in the name of the King of France. He made it all the way to Ottawa, to what's now our capital. I found one of his sextants on a hill, actually. Britain claimed Newfoundland in 1583, and then Samuel de Champlain in 1608 founded Quebec City. Quebec City is actually one of the oldest cities in North America. If you go there, that has a real European feel to it, because a lot of the buildings are 400 or 500 years old. Now, about 300 years ago, you may be interested, the Treaty of Utrecht in 1713 saw France cede part of its North American territories to Britain, namely Hudson's Bay, Acadia, now the province of New Brunswick, and Newfoundland. And then the Seven-Year War started in North America in 1756, as a result of which the Americans ended up giving, the French gave many of the American possessions to Britain with the Treaty of Paris, and that resulted in Britain taking essentially full control of what is now Canada. All the bits of France remain Saint-Pierre and Miquelon, two little islands in the mouth of the Gulf of St. Lawrence, and they're still French territory today. We've had some interesting lawsuits with the French as to how far that territory actually extends for the purposes of resources and fisheries. In 1867, then Canada, and this is why one of the reasons I'm here, because that was 150 years ago. In 1867, Canada was created as a union of various colonial possessions in British North America, and then English and French became the language of the Parliament. But for the first century, and people always say, you know, Canada is such a leader in integration. It wasn't always like that. For the first century of our existence, French and English did really not enjoy equal recognition, and the Francophone population did not enjoy equal access to a lot of opportunities, particularly in government and business, that English speakers enjoyed. So by the early 1960s, there was a bit of a what we call the quiet revolution happening in Quebec, where this subtle form of discrimination really started to rear its head. And as a result of that, Quebec demanded enhanced status of the French language and the French culture, and the federal government established the Royal Commission on Bilingualism and Biculturalism, at that time. And they spent about 7 years creating what we consider to be a fairly realistic portrayal of Canadian society, warts and all, and ultimately came up with a fairly damning assessment saying that we were headed for a crisis, essentially, as a result of the friction between the two societies. They made several recommendations, including declaring English and French to be both equal status Canada's official languages, and improving the balance between the two languages in the federal public service. And that commission was the beginning of our journey into what we now have as multiculturalism. And enacted first Official Languages Act in 1969. And since then, we've really made a lot of strides, and deliberate government policy steps were taken to foster the equality of French and English in federal institutions, in Canadian society, and everywhere else. It culminated in 1862 with the repatriation of our constitution. Until then, we were still legally very joined at the hip with the British system, until I think it was 1932, Canada's Supreme Court was the Privy Council in London, so if you went to appeal to the highest court of the land, it actually wasn't in the land, it was across the ocean in Britain. In 1862, our current Prime Minister's father, Pierre Trudeau, repatriated the constitution, and that enshrines again English and French as official languages of Canada right into the constitution. So that cannot really be changed without major upheavals. And all our laws are printed in English and French, equal access to the courts, equal access to government services. I, as a Canadian diplomat, have to be certified bilingual before I could go out on a posting, so I can serve Canadians in both official languages. And when I give an official statement, say at the Organization for the Prohibition of Chemical Weapons, it has to be half French, half English. So it goes fairly deep down. Today I'm only speaking English, so make it easier on me and you. So we have about 3/4 of Canadians do speak English as a first language, and about 1/4 primarily speak French. And then we also have a large portion of what we call allophones. This is a word that nobody outside Canada knows. We have Francophones, we have Anglophones, and we have allophones. The allophones are the ones whose first language is something that's neither English nor French. Mm-hmm. I am an allophone. Mm-hmm. My native language is German. So, and I'll get to that later on. I think that's, I won't go through the statistics on bilingualism because that's kind of boring. But in the last 150 years, we have really moved on from being a bicultural society gradually into a multicultural society. And since we're just talking about languages, I'm just going to toss out a question. What do you think is the third most spoken language in Canada?
Indian.
Punjabi.
Yeah, Punjabi.
Punjabi.
Mm-hmm.
Punjabi. No, I'm not from. Okay. All right. Yeah. So that's not fair. You have most people guess Chinese, and they would be right if you join Mandarin and Cantonese as one language. But if you separate them out as you should, because they're different languages, then it's Punjabi. So I think what I might want to start doing is play
yeah.
that video and see if I can find it. Okay, you do that for me.
Yeah.
I may be a diplomat and an international lawyer, but I'm illiterate when it comes to computers. You go and figure that out. Okay, thank you. I think it's down there, it's not the
pink.
Oh, it's there.
Okay.
All right. Okay, give us a full screen. Okay, this is a beer commercial.
Oh, there's no sound.
There's no sound, we need sound.
So it's as high as you can go, yeah.
Yeah.
No, no, they are hooked up now.
Yeah, it works. There's no sound.
Can you click on the sound icon down there?
Yeah, it's always.
It's always well, it should work.
Okay.
It's technology again.
So it's not just me.
Let me just check this down.
Minimize the screen maybe and check on the window.
Yeah, maybe on the window, you're right.
So bottom right. Bottom right.
Oh yeah.
Yeah.
See, it's a good thing we have somebody here.
Alright, now it's gonna be loud.
Yeah.
Oh,
okay.
I think we need it. An increasing majority of Canadians these days. See, I know about the X in the comment. Okay. So an increasing majority of Canadians identify themselves as the hallmark of our national identity as being multicultural. About 54% of respondents to a recent survey placed a high-level importance on multiculturalism, which is 5 points up from 2012. So it's still going up, and quite frankly, I have a feeling in response to some of the recent events around the planet, if you did that survey again today, you'd probably find it going up again. Immigrants want and pursue Canadian citizenship at a rate higher than in any other OECD country. About 85% of our eligible permanent residents become Canadian citizens. And that reflects a strong commitment to the country and our values, including multiculturalism and the idea of a pluralistic society. Now, that particular ad, the beer is Molson Canadian. I won't comment on its quality, but they have some great commercials that speak to the national soul. So it's quite possible. It's quite popular. Now, in terms of who we have in Canada, we have about 200 ethnic origins represented in our country, and about 13 of those different ethnic groups surpass the 1 million mark. About 3% of Canadians have Dutch origins. That's about 1 million of Canadians are of Dutch origin. And in terms of religious affiliation, we have 67% Christian, but a growing proportion are other religious affiliations. About, for example, we have 3.2% Muslim, 1.5% Hindu, Sikh 1.4%, Buddhist 1.1%, Jewish 1%, and about 21% atheists or no religious affiliation. And that number keeps going, actually. So we're increasingly secular as well as increasingly multi-ethnic and multi-religious. In terms of visible minorities, we're expected to have, I think, about a third of Canadians are now what you would call visible minority, i.e. non-Caucasian. I always, visible minority compared to what, but it's non-white, I suppose, is the easy answer. And 70% of visible minorities in Toronto or Montreal. Toronto is the most multicultural city on the planet. About 50% of citizens in Toronto were not born in Canada. So it's a real immigrant town, and they've got the most amazing food and festivals there. Mm-hmm. So just to celebrate those kinds of diversity elements. Now, in terms of our sources for immigration, you can kind of track it almost in waves over the years. If you name a big either political disaster or natural disaster, you'll find immigration waves coming into Canada. For example, in the mid-19th century, there was a volcano that erupted in Iceland and made about a third of the country uninhabitable for agriculture. So we had a wave of Icelanders. Now, Iceland is very small, so that wave wasn't very big, but they left quite a bit of settlement and history, and particularly in Manitoba, where they went to Ireland, the potato famine, huge influx of Irish. Then we had the Ukraine, the Holodomor, and the famine. We had post-World War II Germany. Rather than be stuck in a reconstructed country, a lot of Germans came to Canada. Hungary, 1956, with the Russian invasion, 250,000, I think, Hungarians came that year. Vietnam, the boat people, 1970s. Somalia, early 1990s. Yugoslavia, I remember at the height of the Yugoslav secession wars, we took 85,000 people out of the prison camps in Omarska and Prijedor. So again, political crisis, natural crisis, and now, of course, the latest wave is from Syria. Over the past years, we've averaged about 250,000 immigrants a year, which really means about 1% of the population almost a year gets replenished. And that is actually part of really social engineering, because we have, like most Western nations, a declining population, and which means that ultimately we have a pyramid like this, with the top part of the pyramid being people like me, on pensions, living off the taxes of a much smaller population base. So we even that out through immigration to make sure that we can sustain our society. And we have adopted essentially a conscious policy of choosing immigrants who stand to best integrate into our society and also bring benefits to our society. We look at immigrants not as a source of problems or something that we grudgingly accept, but as a source of strength, people that can benefit. And the way the government does that is we have a point system for immigration when you want to apply. And you get points assessed based on your knowledge of one of the official languages, for example, whether you already have family in Canada. That gives you points because that helps in integration. But then also in terms of the kind of professional experience or education that you have. So, for example, about 10 years ago, there was a real shortage of software engineers. We had another wave of immigrants coming in from India because there's a huge population there that is quite expert in software engineering and design. So that changes. I asked one of my colleagues from Citizenship and Immigration the other day, said, what are we looking for this year? And he said, interestingly, one of the groups that they're looking for this year is long-haul truck drivers. Now, remember I mentioned the size, you get in a car and you drive for 1,000 kilometers in a straight line. Long-haul truck drivers, we have a shortage, who knew? Now this year, as I said, we're going to be accepting somewhere between 280 and 320,000 immigrants, of which about 53 will be what we call economic immigrants. About 26% out of the family reunification program, so that somebody who settled in Canada bringing in their parents or their brother or their children. 19% refugees, and then the remaining 1-2% for humanitarian reasons. And a lot of those are people that may have come here, may have come to Canada illegally and might be deported, but for, you know, certain humanitarian compassionate considerations. So it's actually expected that by 2040 that the only population growth in Canada will be through immigration. So you just think about that for a moment. And 1 in 3 workers in Canada at the time will be foreign-born. We're saying right now that I think 20% of Canadians weren't born in Canada. That includes me. As I said, I was born and raised in Germany. I came to Canada as an exchange student, roughly at the age that you guys are, maybe even a little bit younger. Met my husband and got stuck. But I think it's a sign of how our integration actually works that I, you know, 40 years later, I can sit here as Canada's ambassador to the Netherlands. There's no difference made in the Canadian public service based on where you were born or the fact that I speak with an accent, which I do. So that's not a consideration. By first generation immigrants, i.e. these are the children of immigrants, was in 2006, which is the last time we had a long form census, was 6.5 million. So again, out of a population of 35 million. So that's we are a nation of immigrants, essentially. Now, how do we integrate all of that? And encouragement of diversity in identity, essentially, is a policy of the government. In 1971, we became the first country in the world to adopt an official multiculturalism policy. And this arose out of the Royal Commission on Bilingualism and Biculturalism that I mentioned earlier. They did a follow-on report in 1969 that recommended integration, not assimilation, but integration of non-Aboriginal, non-French, and non-English ethnic groups with full citizenship rights and equal participation. And that is what led to our multiculturalism policy. It's essentially challenged prevailing views of Canada as a purely bilingual and bicultural nation, and argued instead that we are really a patchwork, a mixture of peoples from many, many different cultures, all of whom contribute equally. It's I think that particular basis, the legislated multiculturalism, that distinguishes us from many, many other countries, including here in Europe. And we've been practicing it for almost 50 years now, so we've become reasonably good at it. The policy itself was given teeth through, first of all, the Charter of Rights and Freedoms, with its provisions on non-discrimination, the Canadian Human Rights Act, Canadian Multiculturalism Act, which gives the responsible minister a mandate to develop and deliver programs and practices in support of its implementation. Now, this, just to give you a little bit of an example, for example, there's federal funding for Caribana, which is a festival annually in Toronto. It's quite famous, celebrating Caribbean Canadians. And it's a huge party. It's really fantastic food and street parties, and it's amazing fun. And it gets funded by Canadian Heritage, as does, for example, our Pride parades. They're also in furtherance of our approach to diversity. Pride parades get federal funding as well. Now, of course, it's not all sunshine and roses, and I'd be a liar to say that it was. We do have our own share of bigots. We'd like to think that there are fewer of them in Canada than there are in other parts of the world, but there is about a third of Canadians who think that ethnic diversity weakens national culture, whatever they consider national culture to be. And about almost half feel that immigrants should give up their customs and traditions when they come to Canada, as opposed to celebrating them in, you know, separately while integrating into Canadian society. And some hate crime. The statistics, I think the last figure I saw was about 1,200 a year, about half of them based on race, usually targeting Black Canadians. Religion, about 28%, mostly targeting Jews. with an increasing uptick now in targeting mosques. And of course, you will have all have heard about the attack on the mosque in Quebec just a few weeks ago. There's also some desecration of mosques and desecration of synagogues. But it's one of the wonderful things that when one of those instances happens, for example, there was a Jewish cemetery had its tombstones overturned in Saskatchewan a couple of weeks ago, and the local Muslim community came out and they put them back up. Then there was a mosque desecrated in Montreal, and the Jewish synagogue next door came in and their parishioners cleaned it up. So there's, for every bad, there's a good. And I think overall, the good really outweighs the bad. And then about the hate crimes, about 16% are on base homophobic, sexual orientation based. I'm just trying to, leaving as much room as for questions and answer as I can. There's of course also some undeniable racial profiling going on, particularly in law enforcement. I think that happens everywhere. And then of course we do have a need to deal with very specific cultural traditions such as Sharia law, the wearing of the hijab and niqab at certain times, or carrying of the ceremonial kirpan, the knife that Sikhs carry in schools and in courts, has become a little bit of a touch point. But most of those are settled through lawsuits, and the Supreme Court has been pretty strong on providing the necessary accommodations to protect cultural traditions. Now, the Syrian refugees, this is the last big point. Back in 2015, we had elections, and as part of the liberal election promise, our now Prime Minister Trudeau said he would bring in 25,000 Syrians by the end of the year. Of course, the government took power at the beginning of November, so 8 weeks proved a little bit short to do that. Mm-hmm. So they extended it to the end of February. But since then, we've actually taken on over 40,000. So the numbers have exceeded. And one of the reasons that number was exceeded is because of the incredible response by the public to the private sponsorship program for refugee integration. Of those 40,000, about 22,000 were government-assisted people. So these are people where my colleagues in Lebanon and Iraq would go into the refugee camps, work with UNHCR, identify families in need, and bring them over. Then 14,270 were privately sponsored. That's 2/3 of that same number, so 14,000. And then another almost 4,000 were blended, what they call blended visa office referred. These are people that our visa office identifies, but they then refer them into the private sponsorship program. So the vast majority, not the vast majority, but about half, almost half, were private sponsorships. And that works by families or groups of friends, small communities, churches, schools, getting together and sponsoring a family of refugees for a year. They have to make a particular financial commitment. I think it's $25,000, which would cover basic housing. They make commitments on helping them integrate, taking them, showing them how the Canadian medical system works, showing them, helping the kids find a place in school, helping the adults find employment, showing them how Canadian society works. The touching picture I retweeted on my Twitter account a few weeks ago of a couple of Canadians holding the hands of this woman in a niqab and this little kid, showing them how to skate, because of course they hadn't really seen ice before. So it's a very comprehensive and very successful program that really assists in integration. And I have a lot of interest actually here in the Netherlands. A lot of people ask me about that because it's a model that really works well. Now, of course, the challenges are that particularly with the refugees, as opposed to the economic immigrants, there are low levels of education, lack of language knowledge, and health concerns, including mental trauma. When you bring in people that have been bombed for years, there are mental health challenges, post-traumatic stress disorder, and those kinds of things that need to be dealt with. And then, of course, we have to find affordable accommodation, particularly in large cities. Very few of those refugees would go into small rural places although there are some amazing success stories there that they have. But most in the big urban centers, that of course costs more. So that's a bit challenge. Then of course there's a bit of a concern that the government-sponsored refugees have a little bit less of a hand up in their integration than the privately sponsored one. And we do have programs in place that the government puts in language training, training people how to find jobs, assisting in locating employment, health provision, and of course they are also eligible for financial assistance. But integration really happens best when somebody takes you by the hand. Mm-hmm. And I know that from my personal experience. I stayed in Canada because I was with my husband, and I became a Canadian by assimilation as a result. So the deeper you get embedded and the faster, the more successful you are. Our immigrants largely are economically more successful than non-immigrants, the first generation kids, because a lot of the time the parents come to Canada because they want a better life for the children. And by God, they will make it happen. Mm-hmm. So you have our first generation immigrants having a very good chunk of the economic pie in Canada. I think that's probably it that I want to say. I mean, I'll give you a little quote from our Prime Minister, because I'm a diplomat. And he said essentially that Canada's unique diversity is a blessing bestowed on us by previous generations of Canadians who stared down prejudice and fought discrimination in all its forms. Our enviable inclusive society didn't happen by accident, and it won't continue without effort. And I think those are really the key elements. It didn't happen by accident, it's something that we made happen, and it's a work in progress. And I think I'll probably stop there, and I can talk about our cabinet being diverse and having achieved gender parity, but I think you all read that in the paper, so I'm not going there. But I just want to throw the floor open for questions.
Thank you.